I guess, sharing with you what I've learned from my own journey as I learned more and more about the cloud transformation, and what a lot of large industries are doing as they decided over the last probably 5 to 6 years that this was their future, and they started moving towards it. And of course, I'm a industry analyst who covers the security space, so my focus has always been on security. And probably my introduction, you know, I can't understand a new technology or new platforms until I start seeing the security uses or even the security vendors that are learning about it. So of course, over the last 5 years, I've watched as practically every point solution for security that we're familiar with has either been introduced as a cloud solution, or today I think the major trend for security vendors is that they are doing the types of data lakes and analysis that can only be done in the cloud. They're doing it there, so they've got a cloud story. And it's different for everybody, right? The firewall vendors, cloud story is, look, we got all this software that we used to sell in an appliance, so we're virtualizing it and we're going to put it in the cloud. Or identity and access management, and of course, encryption and storage. All these guys have moved to the cloud. But I see a bigger picture, which I hope I can deliver effectively today. Before I start, I'm going to do something audiences hate. I'm going to ask you to raise your hand when I ask you these questions. It'll give us a level set and look around and see what other people say. But first question, does your organization use software as a service? So everybody, right? Next question, and I know the percentage that this will be, have you transitioned to Office 365? 70%, boom. This is why Microsoft is growing so fast, because that's exactly, you know, I saw that trend like 3 years ago, I couldn't believe it. It was probably the fastest shift I've seen in anybody switching to a new platform. It's like everybody I talked to was doing it all at once. And that opened my eyes a little bit, because, you know, as when you're tracking an industry, you look for major shifts. And of course, you know, it would have been visionary if I'd seen it happening 6 years ago, but 3 years ago I tuned into it. Next question is, do you, for your network infrastructure, do you use an MPLS hub and spoke model? Okay, so now we're down to 30%, which is, you know, large distributed organizations have been doing this, the hub and spoke model, for about 40 years. When I got into networking, it was 93, and I started an ISP, and I started to talk to the automotive industry in Detroit, and that's when I started to learn, you know, just selling dial-up circuits was difficult to business, because you had to compete with MCI, who was already selling them $1 million a year of circuits. So they would come in and say, yeah, you want TCP IP over that? You got it. There's no place for somebody just selling ISDN circuits like I did, or fractional T1s. So I'm going to take you through the three stages, at least the way the story makes sense to me from what I've seen. I specifically went out and interviewed 18 large organizations around the world to figure out what they were doing. So there's companies like Schneider Electric, Siemens, GE, Fannie Mae, a cool company called National Oil Well Varco. Each had their different stories of how they approached it. Some were, gosh, it's a security thing. We're more secure in the cloud than trying to maintain all that security stack in our own data centers. Or it was a pure infrastructure. We've got to save money on bandwidth costs and backhaul and eliminate that. Or it's a usability issue, right? Office 365 is one of the things we need to do, but by the time we try and get everybody around the world using it, it didn't work very well. So each had a different approach to it, but each ended up with kind of the same architecture when they're done. So let's talk about moving applications to the cloud. So, you know, the certainly every organization I talk to quickly discovers that various departments had decided that, you know, for CRM, we're going to stop using internally hosted things, and we're going to move to Salesforce. For HR and hiring, we're going to move to WeWork. For financials, we're going to move to NetSuite. And of course, there are thousands and thousands of SaaS suppliers. But when you look at a company like Salesforce and you look at their massive growth, you realize, you know, it's a lot different than just a website and with a database behind it. Salesforce actually is a platform as well, and they can integrate with other tools and help you build other tools. And I was trying to build a simple little app for flashcards because, you know, there are over 3,000 security vendors, and I can't store them all in my head. And I was thinking I'd have flashcards for the security vendors, and I was building an app for that. And Salesforce wanted my business. They wanted me to build the app in Salesforce, so I could have, you know, all those companies in Salesforce and then build an app on top of it. Pretty cool stuff. But when I look at the, you know, one, that huge tower in the middle of the financial district here in San Francisco, you start to realize that, you know, that sort of company isn't built on something that's simple and not non-transformational. So the advantages, obviously, when you're moving to using a cloud app, which everybody is doing, you know, you no longer have the development costs. You know, you're not developing it in-house. When you go to spec it and you ask for a quote for it, like the price is practically on the web page. Obviously, big companies get to negotiate the price, but everything else, terms and conditions, all the rest is just standardized. It's just what you see is what you get. What you see, what you get is huge, and it changes every day. There's upgrades to it every day, and you get those new features, and you never had to upgrade your software or your hardware just because the software was going to change. You never had to go through a test cycle that was all done at Salesforce. And this is repeated for each of these large software as a service vendors. And if you're, you know, if you do the analysis, the total cost of ownership is lower if you take into account all those things, and especially if you take in all the system administrators that you used to have for the stacks of servers in your data center that had to manage those. So the second stage after the SaaS adoption is companies start going, well, we've got applications and everybody is, you know, using all these things on the internet. Shouldn't they be using our applications as well on the internet? Or if we have customers especially, rather than host it in our data center, shouldn't we be moving that somehow to the cloud? And, you know, refactoring comes in these three flavors, lift and shift. So if it's already webified, which it probably already is if it was built in the last 5 years, it's a web front end, database back end, simple thing, just move it to the cloud. And, you know, I'm kind of excited by the serverless that's going on right now. And if you can manage that and not maintain all of the stack of software underneath it, just host the software there and host the data there in an S3 bucket, then maybe that's an even better way to do lift and shift. I see a lot of partial refactoring where, gosh, our data is still considered too valuable or it would be too risky to expose it to the cloud providers that are going to be hosting it. So we'll keep the data in the data center, but we'll move the front end, both the application server and the web front end, out to the cloud, partial refactoring. And then full refactoring, take the legacy software, move everything to the cloud. So now we're going to offer essentially software as a service to our customers, or be they just the internal employees or actual customers. And has anybody seen Albert Behrens' famous pizza diagram? So you've probably seen the diagram that explains the difference between infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and going all the way to SaaS. So pizza as a service is a great, great metaphor. So traditional on-premise hosting of your own applications is what you get if you make a pizza at home from scratch, because you've got to buy all the materials, you got to assemble them into a pizza, you got to cook it in your oven, you got to supply the electricity, and you have to supply the table, the tablecloth, and the utensils to eat the pizza. So infrastructure as a service, you start taking that away, and the metaphor extends to this is when you buy take and bake. So just a frozen, ready-made pizza at the grocery store, you bring it home, and now you're just providing the oven and the heat, but you still got the table and the tablecloth and the utensils. Finally, platform as a service, you go the next step, so the pizza is delivered, but you're still responsible for the table and the utensils. And finally, you go all the way to dining out, and that is pizza delivered as a service. That's kind of pizza delivered, PDAAS. it's just a good way to think about it. And I needed that, believe it or not, when I was digging into this, because it's got to be simplified, and it gets complicated because every platform as a service vendor practically also has infrastructure as a service, and they all deliver a mix of these. So it's really hard, as usual, to put everybody in the right pigeonholes. So from the application transformation that everybody is going through, or maybe if they're not, they should be, from that, do these things. And this is derived from talking to a bunch of CIOs and CTOs and even chief digital officers. They, in a large organization, you can't just start. You got to actually do a little studying and all that. So they actually try and figure out what applications they do have. Unfortunately, as usual, counting things is really, really difficult. Some of the organizations I talked to, they figured out they had 8,000 applications that they had developed and support internally. So if you're gonna, you're not gonna just do something like, we're gonna move them all to the cloud this year. You're not gonna have that. You have to prioritize. But it reminds me of when I was talking to the CIO of the Navy, of Navy Marine Internet. And you may recall when, I think it was HP, you know, when they had the big service contract for managing the entire Navy Marine Internet. That service contract included desktop management for every single desktop inside both the Navy and the Marine Corps. And I was talking to him about, you know, 3 years in, I asked him, you know, so how's it going? And he says, well, we wrote a clause in our contract that said we couldn't start billing until we had ported all of the internal applications to Windows for them. And then we could start charging them, you know, $30,000 a year per desktop for each Windows machine that they supported. And it's been 3 years, and at one naval base, they had 8,000 applications. We had to port from every other systems they had, you know, probably mainframes down to Linux and DEC solutions. They had to port them, and I don't know if they ever got paid on that contract. But you'll find out in your own organization that, yeah, you've got a whole lot of applications. And some are just little scripts that people write to tie things together. And so when you decide which ones are going to have the best payoff quickest, if you're, you know, the CIO, and you start prioritizing how you're going to move those. And you might do the low-hanging fruit, which are the ones that can be lifted and shifted, or the ones that need to get exposure to your customers and partners. And prioritize them on that. And that's when you decide how you're going to move them. But the warning that I have is be prepared as you do this transition for the impact on your network, which brings us to the next phase, which is network transformation. Because everybody I talked to as they went through the application transformation quickly just discovered that there were bottlenecks in their network. And it was just the way that the network was created originally. It wasn't built for everybody to access data on the internet or in these SaaS applications. So as an example, take Office 365. So email is often referred to as the killer app, right? Office 365 is email, and it's a killer app in that it will kill your network if you shift too quickly to it. And if you dig into it, not to be overly critical of Microsoft, but you, even as a Gartner analyst, I would always beat them up because they would just willy-nilly build applications and make up ports to use. And all of a sudden, you know, SQL requests go over port 455, and all of a sudden there's a vulnerability. They don't even know which of their applications were using that port. So they couldn't warn people about what firewall rules to put in. So from that, of course, we had NIMDA and Code Red. It spread around the world over these open ports people had to open up in order to get an application to work. My very short time frame as a network firewall manager, you know, it was really difficult to get an application to work. You put a new firewall in, and basically, anybody who's been there has done this. You put in a rule any to any, so you totally open your firewall. And then the application works. And then you put a rule in, does it break it? Nope, put another rule in, does it break it? And finally, you know, you probably have a bunch of ports open that shouldn't be. And Office 365 is a lot like that. It's a different application than one where you just you know, you log into Salesforce and you're interacting with it solely over HTML. There's more ports for Office 365. It's always got to be on, and it has to be persistent. So everybody in your organization from 8 in the morning to 5 in the afternoon has all these open tunnels to Azure in order to use Office 365. One warning I picked up is, you know, you've got to do bandwidth management on that, because if a couple people start syncing a laptop after they've been on the road for a couple months, come into the office and all of a sudden they're syncing to OneDrive, the entire laptop is being reproduced and it's sucking up all the bandwidth in that office. So you not only do you have to watch out for bandwidth utilization, but there's issues with DNS hairpinning. And DNS hairpinning is the idea that, hey, look at, we're in New York City, and somebody in New York City wants to go to Office 365. The DNS server is locally in the local data center. They probably picked the right path to get to Office 365 from New York. But somebody in an office in Madrid, that DNS server might be in New York. So all of a sudden, you're doing a DNS request, and it gives you the you know, closest path to Microsoft from there. So now you're hopping all across the world until you get to New York City before you actually get on the closest Microsoft Express route to their servers. So big issue, DNS should be cloud-based and distributed. So the closest to you gets you the closest to Office 365. This is a diagram that could have been made 40 years ago, and it describes the traditional hub and spoke. And the reason we needed to do this was we were moving to voice over IP. We had video between the offices. So we bought leased line circuits between all the offices and the regional hubs, usually a data center or maybe the headquarters. And, you know, it always confused me that, you know, MPLS was multi-protocol, you know, and this was, it was designed when there were multiple protocols before everybody just said, you know, we're just going to use TCP/IP, which everybody does, right? I don't see any other protocols going over MPLS anymore except for operational technology, OT stuff. So with that model, when you are going to Office 365, or you're going to Salesforce, somebody in a remote office's traffic is going all the way back to the central headquarters and then out to the internet. So you've paid for all that bandwidth going out, and you pay for it coming back in. And when it's coming back in, of course, you're filtering it through that huge stack of security appliances that you keep adding to. But why do that when they could just go directly to the internet? So the suggestion here is, go to a local internet breakout. And it's surprising to me because I heard this story in 1995 when I was running an ISP. And of course, I was arguing that. Just get an internet connection. You don't need to backhaul to Ford's headquarters to do this stuff. You're just going to Alta Vista and I'm trying to remember, AOL. You don't need to backhaul all that traffic. It seemed like a waste of time and money. Well, it finally is recognized as that. And all the organizations I talked to after they've gone through the application transformation realize that they have to start getting to local internet breakout. And their users are happier when they do that. Because if you're in the remote office, now you just got some broadband connection to the internet. It's usually cheaper to have load balanced broadband connections to two different service providers for the uptime than it is to pay for that circuit all the way back. And what happens is, because it's cheaper to do it this way, and you're eliminating or at least cutting down the size of the circuits you're paying for, is you're saving money. One organization I talked to saw tens of millions of dollars of savings, and it stayed in the IT department, or they managed to claim that savings and use that budget for the refactoring that they're getting onto. And it also plays into the software-defined networking that you hear about, so that the device that you're deploying now at the remote office is going to make that decision for you about which traffic goes to headquarters, which traffic goes out to the internet. So if you're doing that, where does your security stack go? Hold it. Where am I? Yep. If all your cloud traffic goes to cloud apps, where does your security stack go? You are not protecting those people when they're going to Salesforce, right? And they could click on a link and go to the wrong place, and they're not coming in through your inline AV, your sandboxing, your IPS, your firewall, your content URL filtering as they're going out. And of course, all these, you know, I've yet to see anybody draw this diagram well with what you actually have, which is three or four firewalls to handle all this bandwidth, all load balance in three or four IPS solutions. Now, mind you, I used to be CMO of Fortinet. I used to have a slide with the stack on it, and I would argue for collapsing those all into a single platform, right? Which is what the so-called next generation firewalls do. But you still need multiple boxes. Cost didn't go down, you're still paying for all that. But people aren't going through that anymore, so you're losing control over the protection. So that's going to lead to security. I leave you with do this on the network side. Definitely replace your MPLS backhaul with redundant local internet breakout. Use those cost savings to fund the refactoring. Use Microsoft Express Route for getting to Office 365. That was for the first several years, Microsoft was suggesting that because they knew that the latency across the internet was going to make the user experience horrible for Office 365. So if you can get onto, I'll take questions at the end, don't worry. If you can get to Express Route in a couple hops, you're going to have a better experience. So, you know, here's Microsoft building a network to facilitate the usability of one of their SaaS applications. So there's something going on there. So where does Zero Trust Networking play into this? And this is where, you know, we have to take a moment to discuss Zero Trust, because when I walked the show floor the last 2 days, I saw Zero Trust Networking on a lot of vendor displays. Every single one I talked to had part of it, but not all of it. And I had to go through my own mental shift, because I used to think of, when I first heard the term Zero Trust, it meant something a little different, right? It meant for data encryption, it meant you keep the keys and you store the data somewhere else, but you've encrypted locally, so the keys are yours, as opposed to going to a box or Dropbox where they say, don't worry, it's encrypted, but you don't know where the keys are and you don't own them. So that's the data side of Zero Trust. But when people talk about Zero Trust Networking, they are talking about eliminating the IP address from the equation. So now we're just talking about users and applications. And somehow we're going to have to build a broker, a proxy in between the two that knows where things are going. And I'll explain that. So this is what, at the end game, this is what cloud transformation is going to look like, right? So you're going to have some sort of security cloud proxy brokering going on that's doing all the policy application. You're going to have applications, and it doesn't matter now if they're in the cloud, in your data center, in somebody else's private data center. Applications are just there. And you're going to have users, and the users are going to be on any device. So they're going to be on their phones, they're going to be on their tablets, they're going to be sitting at their desktop. And instead of asking the user to install a VPN, and we all probably have experience with VPNs, they're a little cumbersome, especially when you're on an airplane getting ready to take off, they don't work very well. In this case, you're going to always establish a secure connection to a cloud broker, and it is very similar to what we used to call phone home back in the day. So I remember going to Alaska as a Gartner analyst, and you know, of course, you got to have the zinger questions whenever you're talking to somebody, and they are describing the Alyeska pipeline, and they said that they had sensors, you know, on all the pumping stations throughout the Alaska pipeline, which, oddly enough, you know, it's kind of shocking now to think, but they had to fly over that thing all the time. People like to shoot the pipeline because it was above ground. Couldn't bury it in the permafrost, so it was above ground, and people used to shoot at it with their high-power rifles that they use for shooting bears. So there's a lot of security issues, physical security issues. So I was asking them, okay, you've got, how do you get the sensor data, or how do you control a pumping station remotely? And they said, well, it's got a modem, dials back over copper. And you know, probably wasn't quite acoustic coupling, but this was old days. And I said, so I can just war dial all the numbers in Alaska, and I'll find those modems and try and hack into them and get them to take commands. They say, oh, no, we use phone home. If they ever receive a call, a modem hangs up and calls home, calls back to the data center. So that's kind of a cool, pure whitelisting way to control who has access to what. That's how zero trust networking works. So now you authenticate to your Active Directory, just like always, and the cloud security broker sees that you're authenticated, and it goes to the application, which only it knows about, and it says, hey, application, authenticated user A wants to get connected. So the application connects to the end user. So if you're an attacker, you can't just scan all the applications and find them and then try and brute force usernames and passwords. You don't have the opportunity to do that. You never get that far. You never get to see it. And that's why I use the metaphor of stealth, because you've taken it off the radar screen. It's not one of the millions of things you can discover by scanning. It's not the S3 buckets that people keep finding that have all this important data in it, which, a lot of other reasons why that should never, ever happen. But for your own apps, only authenticated users get access to it. So the applications don't broadcast their location. Authenticated users are the only ones who can connect to it. And there's a couple paths to get there, right? You can go with this concept of a cloud security broker who's going to offer it as a service. Or you can build your own. There's protocols now, and there's several people on the show floor I saw that were offering things that got you really close to being able to do this, and you could do it for special applications. I talked to one organization, Man Diesel. So Man Diesel, German company that manufactures giant diesel engines. I mean, the ones that would stretch from to both sides of this room, the kind that I used to see when I worked in the shipyards. But now they're out on, I think they have 3,000 of these engines out there running all the time. And they've got sensors on them, things that they want to monitor, right? Because they're responsible for it. I think they're trying to turn engine sales into a service, right? So here, just lease it for 150 years at $50,000 a year or something. So what they used to do is they used to call the ship and have the engineer on the ship on his sat phone hook it into the computers on the engine and then download all the stuff. So, that was secure. It was just you had to make that connection, during that engineer's shift or something. So they went to a zero trust network, and now they're always connected, but you can't find that ship and you can't tap into it because you're not the authenticated user. But they are back in their manufacturing facilities. So get it right and do this. Number one, when I talked to everybody who was involved in this from these 18 different organizations, they all agree that you can't move down this path until you get identity right. So you probably are using some sort of either Active Directory or basically any directory, be it from IBM or whoever. Get that right before you start down this path. And right to me includes moving to Azure Active Directory. Use the opportunity as you're moving that to collapse everything into a single directory. So if you're a conglomerate, you've got 20 directories, sure helps if they're all in the same tree. But then this explains to me why you look at Okta and how well they're doing. It's because they are a cloud native directory service that they're going to offer you. And Ping Identity, to me, has some similarities to that. Look for the ability to have this cloud policy engine. If you think about it, you're no longer going to be worried about ports, protocols, and the access controls applied at the network layer, because you're only worried about the applications and the users, and then the rights that they have on that. And you're going to do all that in the directory. You still have to do all that security because users are on their cell phones and you don't want them getting infected with malware, ransomware, a worm of some sort. So you still need the ability to scan all the traffic for viruses, worms, attack methodologies, ransomware. You probably have to have an inline sandbox so you can detonate that stuff and catch 0 days if you can. Every organization has to have URL content filtering so you can prevent people from going to inappropriate sites or dangerous sites. Use cloud DNS so you can avoid that DNS hairpinning that causes so many problems. And you're going to have to log all those actions, right? Because you still need that data for compliance. You need to tie it into your SIM eventually. You are still going to be attacked. I'm not saying the attacks go away. So you still have to do threat hunting. So you still need access to that data. But the logs are probably already in the cloud. So you can keep them there. You don't have to move them back and forth into local storage. But be careful, because GDPR requirements are going to look at data flows. GDPR is a 480-page document is laced with requirements for knowing your data paths and data flows. Make sure that the logs don't have personally identifiable information in them. They probably don't, right? It's just logs of browsing activity, et cetera. Just make sure you don't tie it back to anything that's individually identifiable. And that's the end of my presentation. So I can take slides or questions.